I saw the best minds of my generation.
Can literature change American history? Perhaps more than any other work save Uncle Tom's Cabin, Allen Ginsberg's poem Howl did. Shalom. Welcome to David Benkof's Culture Drash. Drash is the Jewish learning term for going beyond the surface of a biblical text. The texts for Culture Drash are creative works by American Jews, a song, a painting, a musical. Here I've chosen a poem, Allen Ginsberg's Howl. Howl was launched at an October 1955 poetry reading at the Six Gallery in San Francisco. When the previously unpublished Ginsberg presented his lengthy, linguistically rich, and shockingly edgy work. By all accounts, the mood was electric. People understood they were witnessing a poetic revolution. What they surely didn't realize was that Howl would change America. More on that later. First, let's listen to Ginsberg read just the first five lines of this 15,000-word poem.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn looking for an angry fix, angel-headed hipsters burning for the ancient heavenly connection to the starry dynamo and the machinery of night, who poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high sat up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats, floating across the tops of cities, contemplating jazz, who bared their brains to heaven under the L and saw Mohammedan angels staggering on tenement roofs, illuminated.
Let's examine the sounds, the words, and the ideas in that opening section of the poem. First, the sounds. Howl is filled with punchy words, plosive consonants, glaring alliteration, and a harsh texture that demands our attention. Listen to all the durs and grs in the second line of the poem, dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn, looking for an angry fix. When he wanted to sound soft, he could do that too. Angel-headed hipsters, ancient heavenly connection, using sounds appropriate for that transcendent language. Now let's look at the words and phrases in this bit of Howl. He pulled together words that usually don't fit together, forcing us to redraw the lazy pathways in our English-speaking muscle memory. He says floating across the tops of cities instead of the more prosaic floating above. He says bared their brains instead of common idioms like blew their brains out or bared their souls. Sometimes he even dispensed with any semblance of conventional grammar.
Who poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high sat up.
And look at this. He says heaven under the L, which on a basic level means under the elevated train, but L is also a Hebrew name for God. So Howl was ear-shattering, even without considering its content. And the content tore down walls of what artists could say. He discussed mental illness and race relations and poverty and drugs and non-Western religions and sex, especially homosexuality. Most of these themes are in our selection. But what about sex? Howl's most shocking content came from the openly gay Ginsberg's use of frank descriptions of anatomy and intercourse. Can you see where, in the first two lines, Ginsberg talks about homosexuality? Here in the word dragging. Drag enabled men to dress up as someone they weren't in order to express something they actually were. So how did Howl change America? It galvanized the beat movement of poets and artists who questioned American conformity in the 1950s. That stance was to flourish in the 1960s, not only among hippies and peaceniks, but also musicians and activists. The question authority stance of the Beats, and of Howl, was essential for the changes in America regarding civil rights, the sexual revolution, modern liberalism, ecology, and gay rights. And Howl started it all. In the next Culture Drash, Andy Leibowitz's Rolling Stone cover photograph of John Lennon and Yoko Ono. For more American Jewish culture videos, press the button to subscribe. My speaking schedule and contact information are below.